Hello everyone, Harry here. Welcome to Scrap Science. The video that I wanted to make this month didn't end up working, and normally in that situation, I turn to one of my backup ideas, but sadly, my backup idea didn't work either, so we're left with this video, which is just me kind of doing some things around the lab that maybe you'll be interested in. Bit of maintenance, and also showing off some new labware that I've got. The basic idea is we're bringing back the Molten Salt Electrolysis series to Scrap Science. It has been more than a year since my last video on Molten Salt Electrolysis, so if you don't quite remember, the goal here is to make metals by Molten Salt Electrolysis procedures. We have had some successes in the past, in particular, in no really clear order, I've forgotten the order that we actually did these things in, we made some aluminium metal. This was made by the Hall-Hérault process, I think it's pronounced, where we electrolyzed some aluminium oxide dissolved in molten cryolite. Aluminium is of course stable in air, so there's no maintenance that needs to be done for that one. Then we made some sodium as well, so this is a bead of sodium that I made from the electrolysis of molten sodium hydroxide. This is stored under oil and it seems to have fared pretty well in the multiple years since I made this, so I don't think that needs much work. Next, we made some lithium. Now, lithium we made by electrolyzing molten lithium chloride mixed with some potassium chloride that makes lithium on the cathode. This, I think, really needs to be worked on a little bit because these beads of lithium are rather small. I'd like to coalesce them into one bead of lithium. And also, the oil that I'm storing them under, there's all this gunk kind of, I doubt it's from like a living thing, but it is definitely unsightly to have in the vial like this. So yeah, one of the goals for today is this lithium we made a while ago. I definitely want to put it into one bead, melt it all together, and then we will give it some fresh oil because this doesn't look very good. Next, we made some calcium. All right, it's gone a little bit black because it's formed some oxides and nitrides on the surface. It is stored under oil. But there's not really much we can do about it, and it's not looking too bad. So I think this can stay as it is. And then finally, we have our magnesium metal. This is also stored under oil. I don't think this needs to be worked on at all. If we tried to melt the magnesium, I think it would just burn up in the atmosphere. So really, first goal of this video is just going to be to kind of fix up this lithium sample that I made a few years ago. Now, melting down lithium beads into one coalesced bead is not a trivial task. With other alkali metals like sodium and potassium, you can just do it under mineral oil because the melting point of those metals is lower than the boiling point of mineral oil. That's not true for lithium. And additionally, molten lithium will react with glass, pretty much. And that fire that results from that is basically impossible to put out. So the only real way to do this is we need to melt down the lithium in some kind of metal vessel. I'm going to be using a stainless steel measuring spoon. And not only that, because lithium is so reactive, it will definitely burn up if we try to just do this in air. We need to do it under molten lithium chloride, for example. Maybe another lithium salt would also work. So the plan here, I have done it before, so I know it does work. It's going to be a little bit tricky, but we're going to fill this with molten lithium chloride. Just with a blowtorch here to get that to melt. And then we're going to just chuck our bits of lithium in there and hope that they coalesce. Maybe we'll have to poke it around a bit. All right, very quickly, there is the lithium we've got. And I'm going to try to coalesce all of it. Normally I would mute a clip like this, speed it up, and maybe put some music over it. But I think it's worth just giving you the raw footage here. So that's what I'm going to do. Right, one bead at a time, this could go badly. Ooh. Please don't explode.
Yes, okay. That is what I want to see. Ooh. Don't do that, please. Oh.
You know, I think the lithium just it likes it when we're on the cusp of making a lithium fire. It likes us being a little risky here.
Right, maybe that bead is big enough for now.
Look, never said it was going to be perfect, but I think we have made an improvement to our lithium. I was able to coalesce it all into two beads, one bigger than the other. Lost a little bit of lithium along the way. I think there's always going to be some components of the molten lithium chloride that the lithium will react with, so we lost a little bit there, but I'd say that's a pretty reasonable chunk of lithium. Much nicer than the previous little globs that we had inside the vial. Now, with the lithium and alkali metal maintenance all done, we're getting into the thing that I really wanted to show you this video, and that's a new piece of labware that I got. You may have seen it in the intro of the video. It is this thing. It may look like just an ordinary crucible, and I guess technically it is, but this is special in the fact that this is a magnesia crucible. So this is a crucible that is 100% magnesium oxide. Now, aside from having just a ridiculously high melting point, magnesium oxide or magnesia crucibles are really nice in the fact that they are completely inert to molten hydroxide salts. Additionally, they're also inert to reactive molten metals like molten sodium or molten potassium. Sadly, it's not inert to molten lithium. That's why we weren't using a crucible like this just before. I don't think there are any ceramics that are actually inert to molten lithium. Regardless, I got this thing because there's been a bit of a kind of part of the molten salt electrolysis series that has annoyed me for every episode so far. In previous episodes, I've been using things like these stainless steel measuring cups as crucibles for melting the salts and actually performing electrolysis. And while these do work, they have been kind of terrible. All right, even back in the early episodes, these kind of just made our molten salts go all brown, whereas in an ideal setting, they should just be a clear molten mass. And then, even worse, in a recent episode, we actually dissolved through one of these things and ruined a furnace. A lot of people will probably say that I could just get a better grade of stainless steel, but to eliminate the problem entirely, I have gone and bought this thing. It's not going to be overly useful. I mean, the only real use cases I can see for this thing are melting sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide. But we've had some big struggles with making potassium metal, and we need all the help we can get, so I've got this ideal crucible for it. I know we did it before in a previous episode, but let's melt down some sodium hydroxide and make some more sodium, I think. I'd really like to see the molten sodium hydroxide in this thing. And it not go brown from the stainless steel from the crucible. And isn't that cool? The sodium hydroxide in the crucible just kind of sits there. It's not discolored or anything, it just kind of looks like water.
bit scarier than water. This is molten sodium hydroxide at over 300 degrees Celsius. And you probably noticed this before, but I've covered the rest of my furnace with aluminium foil. That is just to keep the inevitable splatter of molten sodium hydroxide that tends to happen when you electrolyze it off the rest of my furnace. I don't really like it getting covered in that because it makes it corrode and just leaves a mess all over the thing. So you're going to have to cope with the fact that the whole thing is covered in aluminium. Anyway, I will put the electrodes in and we'll see what happens when we electrolyze this. These are nickel electrodes, supposedly inert to the electrolysis of sodium hydroxide. Anode on the left, cathode on the right. Going to turn that off and get that bead of sodium out. Sadly, the molten sodium hydroxide has gone a bit green due to the nickel that I'm using, but that's kind of unavoidable.
Look, we didn't make an incredible quantity, but I did extract a few little globules of sodium, which I'm storing under oil for the time being. I think if we combine this with the sodium that we made a few years ago, maybe we've cracked a gram of sodium, a whole gram made by electrolysis. I mean, it's a tiny amount compared to what some people do with the electrolysis of molten sodium hydroxide. Some people have built, you know, full, proper cast nacelles to make kilogram quantities of sodium. But that's never been my goal. Today, we just wanted to demonstrate my new crucible. Of course, coalescing droplets of sodium is significantly easier than coalescing droplets of lithium because we can just melt the sodium under some mineral oil. So this is the mineral oil that I was storing it under. We just put it on a hot plate. Everything will melt. We may need to add some isopropyl alcohol to clean up the surface of the sodium and actually make them combine. But as I said, far easier than the job was with lithium. weighing in at 980 milligrams, so close to a gram. That's our chunk of sodium. Combined the run from today and the run from a few years ago when we made about half a gram of sodium, I think. Anyway, I'll put this away. Hopefully it fits in the bottle. Yes, it does. And that's our sample of sodium we were able to make by electrolysis. The thing that really matters here, though, is of course our magnesia crucible. I've just washed it out, and we can see it's a little bit stained on the inside, but it is, as we expect, fully inert to both molten sodium hydroxide and molten sodium metal. So that has fared extremely well. Of course, keeping the future in mind, my next plan, and the whole point of this video as a bit of a lead-up video, is the next metal I want to make by molten salt electrolysis is potassium metal. Potassium metal, as you may be aware, can't be made by the direct electrolysis of potassium hydroxide without any other additions to the setup. If we tried a potassium hydroxide electrolysis in this thing, we would not see any potassium metal form on the cathode. I was almost going to set it up and just demonstrate that it doesn't work, but setting up one of these molten salt electrolysis experiments is quite time consuming, and I don't have that much time left in the day. You can find a whole bunch of other people attempting the electrolysis of potassium hydroxide on YouTube. In fact, I even tried it once with a mixture of a couple of other salts in there. The best you can do is get some fleeting streaks of potassium metal forming on the cathode before they inevitably dissolve into the molten potassium hydroxide melt. Because potassium is highly soluble in molten potassium hydroxide, and as a matter of fact, a lot of potassium salts. I've got two ideas for how we can get around this problem of not being able to make potassium by molten salt electrolysis, but we'll cover those in future videos. My second idea for it will involve this thing. Regardless, I think today was a success. Apologies if this was a bit of a disjointed video, put it together in a bit of a rush. But we were able to conglomerate all of our lithium. We made some more sodium, nearly a gram, and we've demonstrated the inertness of our magnesia crucible. Until we try potassium next time, see you later.